Go ahead and get started.
Okay. Well, good afternoon, everyone, to Front Row with the faculty at St. Joseph's College of Maine. And my name's Joanne Bean. I'm the Vice President, Chief Advancement Officer here. For those that I don't know, I see that we have some alum, certainly some fabulous faculty, former faculty, and some great staff, and of course, the sisters. It's always great to see Sister Joyce and Sister Mary George. My job here is to just go over some preliminaries and sort of introduce the talk and then address the questions that can follow. So you'll notice that there is a microphone that we'd like for you to turn off. If you haven't turned it off, Stephanie Filer, our Director of Alumni Relations, will be turning it off for you. But at the end, after Dr. Connolly has finished his talk, we will entertain questions that we ask for you to submit either in the chat function or when there's a pause, kind of raise your hand, and we will allow you to, of course, jump in, or Professor Connolly will call upon you. So I think without further ado, this is a 1 hour presentation. Half of it will be that presentation from Dr. Connolly, and the other portion will be your questions and your exchange with him. So I'd like to provide some introductory information. His talk is going to be on serving the public then and now, big city mayors versus the modern civil service system. And Dr. Connolly is Emeritus Professor of History and Political Science at St. Joseph's College. He retired in 2020, and that was after 36 years of service. His academic interests have included Irish and Irish American history and labor history. He is editor of They Changed Their Sky, The Irish in Maine, and that was in 2004. He co-authored John Ford in Focus in 2008, and he's the author of Seated by the Sea, The Mountain History of Maine, of Portland, Maine, and its Irish Longshoremen, and that was 2010. And presently, very exciting to learn, he is working on an upcoming novel. The novel is about life in Portland's ethnic Irish community. And it's at the turn of the 20th century, and it's entitled Murky Overhead. So be on the look for that book, which is coming out in the spring, and we can ask him more questions about that. I always ask our speakers, our faculty, to give me a fun fact. And the fun fact that Dr. Connolly presented was that he is a baseball fan, avid Red Sox fan, of course. And he has attended only one World Series game. It was a New York Yankees versus the Cincinnati Reds, the big red machine, so to speak, at Yankee Stadium on Tuesday, October 9th in 1976. The Reds won 6-2, and two nights later went on to sweep the Yankees in that series. How he got in to that game will remain a mystery. So you can ask him that question. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce Michael Connolly, Emeritus Professor of History and Political Science at St. Joseph's College.
I'm very happy to be here, and I'm happy to see familiar faces as well. So before I start, I'd like to say that I was probably the only person at Yankee Stadium that evening cheering against the Yankees, and I had to do it quietly, silently. But I was on my way to Ireland to study for the fall semester. I happened to be in New York, a game happened to be on, and I said, when will I ever get a chance to do this again? So again, how I got in will remain a mystery because I want to keep my emeritus status at St. Joe's. So before I begin, I would like to thank Stephanie Filer and Joanne Bean in particular for helping to set this up in all of the Front Row with Faculty programs. I think it's an excellent way to get our message out there. And a very special thanks, of course, to Troy Hendricks, because without his help in setting up the PowerPoint that you're going to see, well, put it this way, it would have looked very sophomoric if I had tried to do this on my own. So the presentation I'm going to present for you today is looking at big city mayors versus the modern civil service system. And since I was asked to do this in the month of March, which is the month of St. Patrick's Day, I decided to focus on the example of James Michael Curley, the famous or infamous, depending on your viewpoint, five-time mayor of Boston. So you're going to be seeing some film snippets from the John Ford film, The Last Hurrah, which was done about James Michael Curley. And I'll set those up for you. So to begin with, let's talk about patronage. Patronage is defined as the exchange of jobs, contracts, or other political favors in exchange for votes, campaign contributions, or even outright bribes. Now, surprise, surprise, that these things happen in American politics. They certainly happened in the 19th century, they happen in the 20th century, and heavens knows they're still going on today. The civil service was an attempt to, if not get rid of patronage, then at least to bring it under control. A system of rewards by merit, as opposed to rewards by patronage, by who you know, or trying to get something in return. The famous expression goes, to the victor goes the spoils. And although that was talked about in the case of war, it also was true in politics. So today you might often hear the expression, elections have consequences. And we're seeing this already. The Joe Biden team is only in office 100 days, but you've already seen many appointments. And I'm going to end today with one of the most recent appointments that was just made of Marty Walsh, the now former mayor of Boston, who is now just 2 days serving as the Secretary of Labor. So I'll end my presentation with him. And Troy, we can go on to the next first slide if you want. And it's working, that's a good sign. And an even better sign that I see Sarah Eunice here all the way from Baltimore or close to Baltimore. Hi, Sarah. It's good to see your face. A fairly recent graduate of St. Joseph's College, worked for Senator Collins for a good period of time, stayed in Washington, got a federal position where she's working now, and we hope to see her back in Maine soon. This picture, this image is of the most famous political boss of all time, William Boss Tweed, the leader of the Tammany Hall political movement in New York City. Boss Tweed lived in the 19th century. From 1858 on, he led the Democratic Party. He served several terms, both as a representative and as a senator in New York, but his main power source was boards of overseers or various boards of directors, including banks and other very powerful institutions like energy companies. So through this, his political connections, he made lots of money, as you can see in the image in the center. But also, as often happens, people who make a lot of money sometimes misappropriate that money. And the next slide will show two images of Tammany Hall from the outside and from the inside. So you can see from the opulence of that image on the right-hand side of your screen that the money was pouring in and the people working there had lots to work with. So I think that, what I will say is Boss Tweed ended up in jail. He's not the first or last political leader to end up in jail, but in his case, he thought he had made a deal to get out of jail by providing testimony against some of his allies. He provided the testimony, but the governor of New York, Samuel Tilden, reneged on his promise. And so Boss Tweed in 1878 died in the Ludlow Street jail of severe pneumonia. So be careful of how you make your money. Next. He wasn't, of course, the only big city mayor. On the left, you have the image of Jimmy Walker, famous mayor of New York in the 1920s and early 30s. And in the center, you have a picture of Fiorello LaGuardia. And on the right-hand side, LaGuardia is probably looking at a political appointment or maybe even a member of the press. And I think he's giving him a thumbs up there, but I'm not sure. Next. A couple of other famous big city mayors would be Big Bill Thompson of Chicago in the 1915 to 20 period. And then again in the late 20s to the early 30s, throwing out an early pitch probably to either the White Sox or the Cubs. And then on the right, an image of probably the most famous modern big city mayor, Richard Daley of Chicago, who served from 1955 to 1976. Next. Now, other political bosses have been feted in both movies and books. One of the most famous movies, of course, were The Gangs of New York, which starred Daniel Day-Lewis. And you'll see on the right-hand side, Daniel Day-Lewis, and to his left, Leonardo DiCaprio. And also the film had a cameo appearance by Liam Neeson, but he played the role of a priest, but his role ended very abruptly in the movie when he was executed. Next. Most famous film, I suppose, dealing with political shenanigans in Washington, D.C., and in particular, the question of the filibuster, it's been talked about a lot lately, is Frank Capra's Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, starring Jimmy Stewart. And in this role, you see Jimmy Stewart trying to fight for his political survival against a very powerful political boss and the senator from his home state who does the boss's bidding in Washington. It's a classic movie, and anybody who studies political science should know this movie inside and out. This next image is from All the King's Men, which stars Roderick Crawford. So anybody old enough would know 2450 to Headquarters, Roderick Crawford playing the famous role of a police officer. But in this particular role, he played the role of Huey Long, the Kingfisher. Huey Long was the political leader in Louisiana. He served both as governor and as senator. And again, he was feted in the book and in the movie, both by the same name, All the King's Men. The next slide will show a couple of pictures of the true Huey Long. He was exultant, he was a demagogue, he knew how to hold a crowd. He was a showman. There was hardly a speech that he gave that he didn't at least wow the audience, whether you agreed with what he said or not. And I think we have one more that shows that sometimes the people who fly too close to the sun come to a crash landing. So the Times-Picayune of New Orleans reports that Long is shot. I did that in, a Maine accent twice in a row now. And I made a little political joke there, but Long is short, I said, putting an R in where an R does not belong. I didn't do it on purpose, Joanne, even though it looks like I did, but Long is shot. And then on the right-hand side, you will see that the assassination attempt was actually successful. 1935, just before he was politically thinking of running against FDR for president, he was killed by somebody who had been an ally of his, but was done wrong, let's put it that way. Okay, now to get on to the other part of the talk, the United States Civil Service Commission. The purpose of the Civil Service Commission was to select federal government employees to run multiple agencies based on merit rather than political patronage or the spoils system. So the idea behind this was, of course, that people could put friends into high political office. And when you see the snippets of film that we're going to use, you'll see examples of that. The commission wanted to put people into political and civil service jobs based on their ability. The next slide will show you four of the first presidents that were responsible for creating this system, starting with Ulysses Grant on the left, Rutherford B. Hayes, James A. Garfield, and then Chester Arthur, spanning all the way from the 1870s up through the 1880s. So these were the early people promoting this idea. The Pendleton Act in 1883 required the civil service exam, of course, based on merit. The Hatch Act in 1939 prohibited political activity on the part of civil servants, again, to separate politics from the civil service. The Civil Service Reform Act of 1978 said that state and local agencies should also be based on the federal model. And going up to the 21st century, we have now, it's estimated, several hundreds of thousands of civil service workers, the vast majority of them, surprisingly, working outside of Washington, D.C. Sarah might be surprised to hear that, but roughly 84% of civil servants work outside of the Washington, D.C. area. Okay, now I'm going to go on to the example of the most famous big city mayor of all. And let's go on to the next slide. James Michael Curley. Some of you might be more than familiar with him. If you're from Boston, you would know him. He has statues and other mementos to his memory. Five-time mayor of Boston. Vote often and early for James Michael Curley. And Tip O'Neill used to love to sing a song about Curley. And one of the lines was, when he was speaking, you could hear him all the way up in Biddeford, Maine, because he had a great speaking voice. John Ford was interested in Curley because John Ford was actually John Martin Feeney, and he was born of an Irish Catholic family in Cape Elizabeth and grew up on Munjoy Hill in Portland. So on to the next slide. The Curleys and the Kennedys had a close relationship. In the first slide, you'll see a picture of Honey Fitz, upper left-hand corner. That was John Fitzgerald, Honey Fitz, as he was called, the father of Rose Kennedy and the mother of the future president of the United States. Below that, you have a picture of Honey Fitz and also Joe Kennedy and JFK on the right. So you have, on the right-hand side, you have the three generations, Honey Fitz, his son-in-law, Joe Kennedy, and then Joe's son, John. John was not intended to be the president. His older brother, Joseph, was meant to be, but he died in a World War II aviation accident. Now, this picture might seem out of context, and the sisters will recognize this image immediately as the first American saint, Mother Cabrini. And the question you might be asking me is, what on earth has Mother Cabrini got to do with the civil service or anything else that I'm talking about today? But when Troy goes on to the first snippet, lasts about 3 minutes, you'll find out what Mother Cabrini has to do. And at the same time, you'll find out how Mayor James Michael Curley operated. So Troy, let's give this a shot. And hopefully the volume will be good.
Maeve, honey, we got company.
Well, how do you do, Mr. Uncle Frank? So nice to see you again.
Thank you.
Won't you come in?
Thank you.
Nice to see you again.
Honey, let's get something to eat.
Do you know, your mother was the prettiest girl who ever lived in the Third Ward. Except one. And that was her mother, Ellen, your grandmother. And do you know that you You look exactly like her.
Do I really?
Indeed you do.
But my father says you try to be all things to all people.
Oh, no, no. No, no. I try to be only one thing, their mayor. But of course, sometimes that requires a little juggling, you know. You know the trick, babe, is to know what the people want. Mm-hmm. And then what you can settle for. You see, you can always promise the first, but you really only have to deliver the second.
But what if people want entirely opposite things? How can you satisfy everybody?
Then you depend upon man's greatest friend, the compromise. I can give you a case in point. Do you remember, Adam, the statue I promised for them down in the park at Little Italy?
Yeah, that was Christopher Columbus, wasn't it?
Well, yes, his name was mentioned, but that happened to be at a communion breakfast of the Knights of Columbus, you know. Now, the next day, the Sons of Italy got hold of me, and, of course, they plugged for Garibaldi. The following day, the Athletic Club called me, and they wanted Rocky Marciano. And then a band of enthusiasts got together, believe it or not, and suggested the Cardinal. Now, Mai, what would you do in a situation like that and still not make enemies? Now,
I don't know. What did you do?
Well, I'm going to make my announcement tomorrow. Going to be the first act of the newly elected mayor. Mm-hmm. The statue is going to be of Mother Cabrini.
Mother Cabrini?
Italian-born, first American saint. Let's see somebody fool around with that one.
Let's see somebody fool around with that indeed. So, if you want to go on, Troy, to the next image.
Maeve, honey, we got...
There we go. Troy, you're doing a great job. Now, here's a juxtaposition for you, but I hope I can make it make some sense. The next film clip that I'm going to use from The Last Hurrah deals with this man on the left, believe it or not, Cotton Mather, one of the early leaders of the Puritans of early Boston. On the right, you see a depiction of the witch trials that happened famously in Salem, Massachusetts. And Cotton Mather and the Puritans, of course, had their own suspicions about the devil's work in this country and in individuals. The film clip that you're going to see next from The Last Hurrah deals with a visit that James Michael Curley, in the form of Frank Skeffington, played, of course, by one of the most famous actors in American history, Spencer Tracy, visiting the Plymouth Club, and in particular going upstairs to the Cotton Mather room. This is an incredibly humorous, well, it's an important scene, but just setting it up a little bit for you, you can be paying attention a little bit to two of the most famous actors in there. You'll of course see Spencer Tracy, but you'll also see a banker by the name of Mr. Norman Cass, played by Basil Rathbone. And you'll also see a newspaper editor by the name of Amos Force, played by John Carradine. There's also another important actor in here who plays the role of Bishop Gardner, in this case, an Episcopal bishop. So Troy, let's see what happens when he goes to visit the Cotton Mather.
Mr. Skeffington, don't worry, it's not a hold up. All right, come on, beat it.
But I beg your pardon. I'm a member here.
Remarkable. Still breathing the same air they brought over in the Mayflower.
Hello, Robert. I believe Mr. Norman Cass is having lunch here today with some of his friends.
Yes, sir, Mr. Winslow, in the Cotton Mather room.
The Cotton? You're joking.
Honest to God.
What do they use for decorations up there, huh? Burning witches? Dunking stools?
I wouldn't be surprised.
Pick yourselves a nice, comfortable pillory, gentlemen. I'll be down presently.
Mr. Skeffington.
Gentlemen, I bring alarming news. The redcoats are coming.
Oh, but sir, you can't go up there. No person who is not a member may go beyond the first floor.
And I don't wonder. The place is obviously a fire trap. Look at those banisters. Just flimsy. And that door, is that a fire door? Don't you know that every fire door is required by law to be covered by metal? Inspector, make a note of that.
I will, sir.
Look at that. Got a pencil on you?
Huh. You settle the matter. You read my editorial this afternoon, you'll see that I...
Gentlemen, please forgive this intrusion, but I claim the privileges of House Rule 12. And I come on a matter fully as important as fire, floods, and Indian attack.
Mr. Mayor, you have never ceased to amaze me. Well, gentlemen, do we invite his honor to join us in a cup of coffee? Or shall we just sit here in outraged dignity?
I, for one, refuse to sit at the same table with
you. Sit down. Since you admit it is an intrusion, Mr. Skeffington, what do you want?
Well, not coffee at any rate. Thank you very much, Bishop Gardner. What I want, very simply, is what your distinguished ancestors, the Pilgrim Fathers, wanted when they came to these shores 300 years ago. Better living conditions, specifically in Ward 9.
I call this confounded impudence.
Please. You had your answer to that this morning.
Well, I came in the hope that you might change your mind.
Sorry.
Are you speaking for Consolidated only, Mr. Cass?
I believe I'm speaking for us all.
Indeed, you are.
No reason to change.
Oh. Well, now that does pose a problem. I hate going to the press and reporting that the city's leading bankers are opposed to slum clearance.
You may report, sir, that the banks do not consider this city a good financial risk. Under your administration, we prefer to wait until the municipal situation has changed, at least to some extent.
To the extent of a new mayor, is that it?
Precisely. Now, if you'll have the goodness to
leave... I can't say that I blame you entirely for wanting me out of office. But, gentlemen, please don't use this housing development as a political football. I tell you, there isn't a day goes by that some kid isn't run over down there playing in the street because he has no place else to play. And do you know how many cases of pneumonia we took out of those cold water flats last year alone? Would you have it on your conscience that because
Mr. Skeffington, before appealing to our conscience, I suggest that you consult your own. We have not jeopardized the city's credit.
There is nothing wrong with the city's credit, and you know it.
That we happen to differ.
On that and one or two other points. But it really all boils down to one, doesn't it? The fact that the city is no longer yours, it's ours. You have this musty shrine to your blue-nosed ancestors, but my people have the city hall. And that's what sticks in your craw. You can't swallow it, you can't forget it. Well, I'm going to make you eat it. That housing project is going up as planned, and it's going to open on schedule. And you know what day that's going to be? St. Patrick's Day. And I'm going to lead the parade right down here past those windows to remind you of this promise I'm making now. And now, gentlemen, I'll bid you good day.
Mr. Mayor, aren't you being a bit too Irish? Certainly what you said may have been true once. The jealousy, the resentment we old-time Yankees had for your people when you first began crowding in. I'd say it was natural enough. But look at what's been happening. Our boys and girls are going to the same schools and colleges. They're intermarrying, raising families.
No child of mine will ever marry one of them.
That's not surprising, Amos, considering that you're a bachelor. There's just one thing more, Mr. Mayor. We Yankees have been termed hard and flinty. Our Puritan heritage, no doubt. But we love this city just as deeply as you more sentimental Irish claim to love it.
Claim to? You don't think that I honestly do?
Yes, I honestly think you do. You know, you haven't won entirely by the Irish vote. I've occasionally voted for you myself. I may again.
Thank you, Bishop.
Mr. Skeffington, in spite of the fact that you're the mayor of this city, you have no right...
A derby, wasn't it, Your Honor?
Yes, yes. Whose is that? Sir Thomas Lipton? Didn't know he was a member. How did he get in?
Oh, no, Your Honor. That's Mr. Norman Cass Jr.'s, the Commodore.
Oh, of course, the Commodore, yeah. Yes, you remember the Commodore. Classmates.
If you must rub it in, yes.
Yeah. Take the Commodore's hat and find him.
He'd be in the bar.
Have him in my office.
But...
In an hour. I wonder if I could leave a little message with you for Mr. Cass Sr. Would you tell him that I shall expect him at the City Hall the first thing in the morning?
First thing? At the City Hall? Yes, Your Honor. I will, sir. And Your Honor, don't let on, but...
You're a man after my own heart.
All right, let's try the next slide, if we could. So I'm going to try to speed up a little bit because I'm losing time. I'm hoping that you're enjoying these film snippets. It's one of my very favorite films, even though it was not critically acclaimed. I love it. I love that line, especially when Amos Forrest gets up and says, "No child of mine will ever marry one of them," meaning an Irish Catholic. And the bishop reminds him that he's a bachelor. Okay, so James Michael Curley had books and movies and articles written about him. I mentioned this before. This was Patrick Deneen. James Deneen, actually, Joseph Deneen, The Purple Shamrock, that's Joe on the left, and a cover of his book. And next, The Last Hurrah by Edwin O'Connor, from which the name of the movie comes, The Last Hurrah. Edwin O'Connor also did All in the Family. Again, another one of those memory names that will reverberate to people who watch that series, All in the Family with Archie Bunker. And now I think we're going to see the last snippet. This is a brief one. And this little snippet goes to show how the opponents of Frank Skeffington, or James Michael Curley, tried to beat him at his own game by putting up an Irish Catholic to run against an Irish Catholic. And in this particular case, in the movie, they picked a bumbling idiot. And I think that you'll see this from the little snippet that you're going to see now of the interview, the television interview that was done in his home. So we'll try this now.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, the coalition candidate for mayor, Kevin McCluskey. Won't you sit down, Mr. McCluskey? Now, tell me, Mr. McCluskey, how do you feel the campaign has been going?
I feel fine. I honestly do. And it's my honest belief that it's been a wonderful campaign. And Jack, I honestly believe, speaking in all sincerity, that when people realize the issues of
honest government,
of honest government, that they will flock to the polls in great numbers.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, Mrs. McCluskey.
Dear? Mignon?
Mrs. McCloskey? Mrs. McCloskey? Well, Mrs. McCloskey, I see you're being the dutiful wife.
Ah, Charlie, isn't that a darling picture of American home life?
We'll win in a walk.
A posterior for posterity. I'll have one enlarged for your headquarters.
Get away with that thing.
Tell me, are you enjoying this campaign? Well, how does it feel to be the wife of the candidate for mayor?
Oh, it feels absolutely wonderful, Mr. Mangan. It makes me very proud of my husband. But then, I have always been proud of him.
And
of the children.
Yes. I understand they just came downstairs with you. Did you have any trouble with them, Mrs. McCloskey?
Oh, no, except for Valerie. Valerie, I was just putting Valerie to bed, but nothing would do but that she come too.
Well, she's a wonderful little tyke. Oh, there they are. Come right in, children.
Come on, children. Come right in now. Valerie, come on. Come on, Valerie. That's a girl.
That's a cute little one there.
There you are. All right, now curtsy,
how
girls.
Oh, that's it. Go to Daddy. Ladies and gentlemen, the lovely family of Kevin McCloskey, your next mayor.
Good night, Ernest. Good night, President.
Good night, Bishop.
Thank you, Graves. I was watching your man on television. The answer is no.
Perhaps you didn't understand my call. We're not asking for money, merely your endorsement of his candidacy.
That's right, Bishop. Just a simple statement from you as one of our most prominent churchmen.
No.
You mind telling me why?
I don't like him.
That's one of the funniest scenes in the whole film. I think I could see Sarah Poirier laughing at that one and thinking that was not the best political campaign ad ever made. Okay, so I'm going to try to finish up fairly quickly now. This is a picture of Jack Beatty on the left, and he wrote the most definitive work on Mayor Curley, and he called it appropriately the Rascal King. And next. And I wanted to just make mention of the fact that not just the Irish, but people of all races, ethnicities, religions, et cetera, have used politics to try to get a leg up in America. On the left, you have a picture of Keisha Lance Bottoms, the mayor of Atlanta, and there's John Lewis with her. And on the right, you have a picture of Muriel Bowser, the mayor of Washington, DC, with former President Obama. Here you have a picture of, and I was going to say Boston's mayor, but when I made this slide, he was, but now he's the former mayor of Boston, Marty Walsh. Below you have a picture of Marty Walsh with a former Taoiseach or Prime Minister of Ireland, Liam Cosgrave. He's well in his 90s in this picture. And he was the Prime Minister of Ireland when I first studied in Ireland in the 1970s. On the right, of course, you have a picture of, he was not the president at the time, and Marty Walsh was not his Secretary of Labor, but there's a picture of Joe Biden and his newest cabinet appointee, Marty Walsh of Boston. And the last slide that I have is a picture of a famine cottage, typical of what people like my grandparents came from in Califeenish and Weenish in the far west of Ireland. This one happens to be in Rossmuck, where Marty Walsh's mother hailed from. And on the lower side there, you have a picture of Pierce's cottage. This would be the cottage of the famous signatory of the Easter 1916 rebellion, Patrick Pierce, who studied the Gaelic language out there. And the final picture on the right-hand side is a picture of Karna, which is very close to all of these places. My grandparents came from 2 miles one side of Karna and 2 miles the other side of Karna. And if you look carefully at that picture, you'll see a ruined building in the center right. Well, that was an old public building. The roof had caved in, but they resurrected that building, and it's all refurbished now as the Immigrants Commemorative Center. And I'm proud to say that Marty Walsh and I both serve as patrons of that center. So with that, I conclude my presentation and I'm open for questions.
Thank you so much, Professor Connolly, Michael. Everyone, I think we have the chat function up and running. So if you wanna use that or if you just wanna call out a question, now's the time.
Are we able to go back where we can see more of the faces, I wonder?
Yes, that's what we need to do.
Professor Connolly, this is Jessica. I have a question for you.
Yes.
I'm interested in what your personal opinion is with how the mayor position is now, how it now functions in Portland. You know, it used to be somebody would volunteer.
Right.
And now it's an elected position.
Yes.
My husband is born and bred in Portland. And that change happened while we were in Chattanooga for my employment for 3 years. And he absolutely can't stand it. You know, so I'm interested in hearing what your opinion is.
Sure. As a historian, I have to go back a few years. So the original mayor system was changed in the 1920s, and that was a period of ethnic unrest, let's put it that way. The KKK was very active in the South, but also in the North. It was not just anti-Black, but also anti-Catholic and anti-immigrant. So a strong mayor was not favored by the people who had formerly been in control of the cities, as depicted in the movie, the ones that would have been members of the Plymouth Club. So what they did was to put in a strong city manager system and a lot of people who will be elected at large, which means that it takes a lot of money to run for that position. So later on in Portland, we developed a system where the mayor would be chosen from among the 9 city councilors. And the mayor's position back then, when I was, let's say growing up and until fairly recently, was a ceremonial position. Somebody would be nominated by their fellow councilors, and they didn't really have any more power than really ceremonial functions and also chairing the meetings. But a few years back, they wanted to put a stronger mayor into office and have that mayor be publicly elected as an at-large member of the city council with many more powers. Michael Brennan was the first, Ethan Strimling was the second, and now Mayor Snyder is the third. Sometimes it's been a little rockier than others, I will admit that, but I personally like the system, and I like the fact that it's elected by ranked choice voting or instant runoff voting, which means that somebody has to get at least 50% of the vote. And since at least the first two people were identifiably Democrat, and Portland is a Democratic city, it means that they're running among themselves, you might say.
Yeah.
But I like the instant runoff aspect of that, and it makes, it's at least theoretically, it makes for a smoother transition. So I do like it.
Okay, thank you.
Are we just open for questions now, Joanne? Is that?
Yes, we're open for questions. And I have one, if I could ask. I just wanted to know, Michael, how did you become interested in James Michael Curley? What first brought your attention to him?
I couldn't have asked a better question myself, Joanne. when I was at Boston College, my advisor suggested that I do my dissertation on James Michael Curley. There hadn't been a definitive work done for many years at that point. I'm lucky I didn't choose that because Jack Beatty's book came out shortly after that, and it's a marvelous work. So that would have been a tough one to compete against. But I told them what I really wanted to do was to study what I know, which was the Irish longshoremen. And Sister Mary George's father was one of them. And I was lucky enough to interview him at his house on Danforth Street in Portland, and several others of the those that survived the longshore. I interviewed them in the early 1980s. And so most of them were in their 80s at that time, having been born around the turn of the century. And that ultimately resulted in my book, Seated by the Sea. So I think I was lucky that I followed my own stars.
Very interesting.
I have a question, Mike, if you can hear me.
Yes, is it the one that I prompted you to ask me yesterday?
Mike, can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Okay.
Yeah. Is the era of big city bosses over? Are there any big city mayors today who would sort of qualify?
Well, I kind of briefly went over that talking about a couple of African-American mayors. And I had looked into this situation, and even just in the South, Atlanta, Keisha Lance Bottoms, New Orleans, LaToya Cantrell, Charlotte, North Carolina, Alexander Lyles, Dallas, Texas, Eric Johnson, Houston, Sylvester Turner, Richmond, LeVar Stoney, Washington, D.C., Muriel Bowser. So all of these are African-Americans who are using the political system today to help their city, but also by extension, help their own group. So I think that it still lives today. Of course, there are great restrictions on what they can do, especially raising money and dispersing money.
But there's really no sense that they are abusing power, though, it seems to me.
I think
is that right?
I agree.
I mean, they seem to be very well respected mayors.
I think all of them, the ones that I mentioned, are. And I think there's many more restrictions that are placed on these mayors today legally, but also there's a lot more journalistic overview of what's happening. A mayor gives a talk or makes an appointment and everybody in the city knows about it before the evening news comes on. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm sure Sarah has a question from down there in Maryland somewhere.
I do have some comments, but I don't have time to say them all. But I will say that Troy deserves lots of credit and a big round of applause for helping with all the technology. I remember it all too well. And thank you for inviting me to this today. And it was very nice to be in the position of being your student again. It brought back a lot of memories. So thank you.
I also think that here's your chance to help to thank Ed Riley for the support that he gave you with your poetry.
I know. I need to meet Ed in real life.
Hi.
Michael, I think it's a tribute to Mayor Curley, who said, cast your bread upon the water, and if the ducks don't eat it, it'll come back to you. Are you familiar with that saying?
Yes, he certainly did know his Bible, but as they say, the devil can quote the Bible for his own good.
Well, I don't think that's the Bible. Cast your bread upon the water, and if the ducks don't eat it, it'll come back to you. Is that the Bible?
The first part of it certainly is.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, cast your bread upon the waters is certainly from the Bible. But I think that's a great example of him using the Bible for his own purposes by the changes that he made to the quote.
Thank you.
Yes, you're welcome.
I have a question, Mike.
Yes, hi, Alex.
How's it going?
It's going great, thank you.
So in the context of, there's all sorts of conversations about globalization and, the globalization of the economy, all these other things. Recently, there's been a lot of academic work done that specifies that it's not really globalization, it's regionalization, and that it's, you know, big cities, especially in the global north, that it's not so much about international interaction, it's about the interaction between cities that's really been spiking as of late. And so I wonder, and would like your thoughts on, perhaps the sort of patronage of the olden days has become more of a meritocratic process as a result of the fact that you just have these massive, largely, maybe transparent is too strong a word, but people have more access to information now. Yeah. And so as a result, the way that power and all these things express themselves are more, they lend themselves better to civil service than old school boss work.
I understand your question. I think it's a very good one. The best example that I can think of to answer, to partially answer that from current events would be the way that a lot of governors and big city mayors, especially in the Northeast, banded together to fight the pandemic. I'm thinking in particular about, but then it included much of New England at one point. And also governors from New England tend to get together on a fairly regular basis and talk about problems or concerns that deal with them regionally, not just their own particular state. Tourism is an excellent example of that. So by trying to urge people to come to New England instead of just come to New Hampshire or just come to Rhode Island, they get more bang for their buck. And there's other issues that can only be solved on a regional basis. For example, a river that flows through multiple states, those kind of things. So I think the gist of your question is accurate. And if we need meritocracy to answer that, so be it. If we need a little bit patronage to answer that because you know somebody that's good, maybe there's a common ground there.
Mike, this is Jessica again. You opened up the window when you said governors for me. And I think during this COVID pandemic, one of the things that has really surprised me are the differences in how the governors are handling COVID-19 pandemic within their respective states. I would be interested in hearing your thoughts on that because the response and their reactions have been so wildly different. And on that note, you know, last year at this time, I remember watching TV and every single day, Andrew Cuomo was on TV doing every single day what he was doing for New York City, New York State and New York City. And I looked at Mark and I said, he's gonna run for president. And now look where he is. And so, I'm interested in hearing what your thoughts are with governors, COVID, their reactions and so forth.
Good. I think when you're thinking of running for governor in or president in this particular day and age, with media being what it is, you have to be squeaky clean. And I think he ran into a little bit of a buzzsaw there. I'll give you, to answer your larger question, two examples from the opposite ends of the Atlantic coast. In Florida, you had a governor who, in many cases, did not follow the science. In some cases, actually went against the advice of the CDC and others and opened up as quickly as possible. And Florida, in particular in the Miami area today, is going through another resurgence in the pandemic, but in particular of one of the strains of the pandemic that is very dangerous. And the recent episodes of the spring breakers that were down there in Miami and now heading back to all 50 states is a cautionary tale. On the other hand, you have Janet Mills here in Maine, Now, she has been heavily criticized by some in the business community for being too slow to open up businesses, and some in the religious community, in fact, for restricting numbers of people that could go to religious services. However, on the other hand, Maine has been relatively much more effective in controlling the spread of the virus and getting the vaccinations out than most other states. So I think when the history of this is written, the ones that listen to the CDC are going to get much more credit, and the ones that ignored it for their own reasons, I think will pay a political price. I could be wrong on that, but I think that's my instinct tells me that.
Michael, is there an opportunity for you to share with us a little bit about Murky Overhead?
Oh my goodness, thank you so much for asking. I just received the manuscript back from the publisher today. That might be the last chance I get to edit. And it's so exciting because Murky Overhead has been anything but murky for me. It's been in my mind, you could say, since I was a child, because it's recollections from my mother, from my father, stories about my grandmother and grandfather, stories from the Irish longshoremen that I interviewed, stories from my time in Dublin and Galway. In other words, it's kind of a mishmash of all the things that I've experienced. And I try to put all these things into one day in Portland, Maine, in January of 1900. And it's about 360 some odd pages, so it's a fairly large novel, but it should be coming out. It looks like maybe Amazon in the next couple of months or so. And I'll be happy to share this with you so that you can share it with others from the St. Joe's community. And then when times are better, I'd like to do book launches like Ed used to do when his poetry books would come out. And Sarah has just recently done for her poetry reading down in the DC area. I'd like to do something at St. Joe's and particularly at the Maine Irish Heritage Center. So thank you very much for asking, and I'll keep you appraised, but things are moving quickly.
Well, that's wonderful. And I can just say that an advertisement would be that when I first started at St. Joseph's, I lived in Mudjoy Hill for a little bit, and someone invited me to a talk because there was a professor who was going to talk about Ireland, and he was from St. Joe's. So I went to that talk, and I was mesmerized by a man who could talk to you about every single home going up the hill to Mudjoy Hill, who lived there, what happened, what school they went to. It was amazing. So now that I know a little bit about your book, I'm excited to read it. So, and I'm sure we all are. It also sounds like you brought a wonderful opportunity for us to think about, Stephanie, perhaps an SJC authors gathering of some sort, because there are not only faculty who are authors, but certainly folks like Sarah, who is an author, and we need to hear more about you, so.
I think that's a great idea. And there's Ed there with more books than he can carry in two hands. And Sarah's just starting out with her publishing. And for me, I have three academic books out, but this was a real challenge to do a novel and especially to get it published. So, but you've got Steve Ridge with his works out there and so many others. I think that would be a great idea, Stephanie, for maybe next academic year.
Great. Well, we are 5:01, but there's not another immediate question, I think all of us know how to reach Professor Connolly, and if not, certainly email the college and we will get your questions and your comments to him. But I want to thank you so very much, Michael, for the great presentation, and Troy for your wonderful help, and all of you for participating. We hope to open the campus at some point when we get pretty close to herd immunity there with vaccinations. So in the meantime, be well, take care of yourselves, and stay tuned for the next Front Row with the Faculty, which is going to be, I believe, Stephanie, is it Professor Green, I think? Yes. So again, it's the second.
Oh no, I'm sorry. It's Johan Eriksson and Greg Teagarden.
Thank you. So that'll be about environmental science and the sciences. And again, Front Row with the Faculty is held on the second and fourth Wednesday at 4 o'clock. We'll see you again.
I had one more thing to say, and I forgot at the beginning. I wanted to thank Stephen King for being my lead-in act.
Yes, we were able to talk about you on his performance. So that was great.
Thank you all for coming. Great to see all your faces.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you, everyone. Be well. Take care. Bye.